Hey guys, and welcome back to the channel. In today's video, we're going to talk about the things that I wish I knew before modifying my Subaru WRX. I drive a 2016 Protune Subaru WRX, which I absolutely love, and I will show you guys an intro very shortly about my car. In this video, I'm going to tell you guys exactly the things that bother me and all the things that I think you guys should know essentially before you consider buying a Subaru WRX or STI and modifying it. But before we start that, let's start with a little bit of a pull here, just nice and slow because there is some ice on the ground. It wasn't too fast. There's usually cops around here, so just gotta be a little cautious. It's also really cold and icy, so just a little bit of, you know, a little bit of fun there. We are gonna be driving through some back roads here. Nothing too crazy in today's video. And guys, before we get too far into this video, if you wanna see more automotive content, Subaru WRX content, any kind of cool tuning content, be sure to subscribe to the channel. We'd love to have you here, and there's some cool videos coming up as it gets warmer. So the big question is things I wish I knew before buying and modifying my WRX. Now the key here is I don't wish I knew anything before buying the WRX because I think this car is absolutely amazing and everybody should go out and buy them. And I'm not kidding here, guys. Usually I say that as a joke, but I'm truly not kidding here. This car is a fantastic car. It's my favorite car that I've ever owned to date. So that should say something as somebody that's driven quite a few cars and constantly is in and out of cars that are modified. And yeah, that's some perspective. There are some very real things I wish I had known before getting into the whole WRX and STI modification community and world. And there are definitely some things that are oversold to you guys as owners. I wish somebody had told me because everybody says like all positive things and nobody ever talks about the negatives and the challenges and the things that everybody truly faces on a regular basis. If you want some juicy Subaru WRX content, it's gonna be here and I'm gonna talk about it. So the number one thing that I wish I had known and somebody had told me, and it's something that you truly can't, like unless somebody is telling you and you find somebody that's honest, which I am very honest, I promise you guys, if you have followed the channel, I talk about pretty much every problem that I've ever encountered with this WRX, and WRXs and any kind of cars that I own and deal with. The reality though is not very many other people are, and they, you know, they look at WRXs as extremely easy to modify, no problems, open community, very positive community, everybody says hello, you can make crazy powers with no problem, you can make crazy power with no problems, it's gonna cost you nothing to make that power, etc. Which is all kind of fine and true, but there are some caveats. The first thing, and this is the primary myth, I suppose, that I wish somebody had been clear, is it's not as easy to make power reliably than you think. Now, when you deal with cars with higher horsepowers, your percent gains and your gains are a little bit bigger proportionally, right? We can all agree with that. But what you actually feel with the car is a little bit different. Having driven smaller sports cars that have less power, and typically the WRX is an entry-level sports car for a lot of us, the sound of an addition of, 15 or 20 horsepower sounds pretty significant. Now, don't get me wrong, that's awesome if you made that extra 15 or 20 horsepower, but in no world are you ever going to feel that while you're driving the car. Many of you say, who cares, but this is a big thing to consider when you're going to buy a WRX. When people say it's easy to make a lot of power in them, they're essentially saying it's easy to make a lot of power, assuming you're ready to throw your warranty away if you have one. Why do I say that? Because you need a J-pipe. Power is made with a J-pipe. Yes, you can get a tune without one. You can run an intake. You can do a few other little things that are questionable with warranty because you're already tuning. But if you want real power, you've got to throw a J-pipe on and you're definitely out of warranty at that, or you're definitely going to get denied a warranty claim for the most part if that's the case and something goes wrong. So that's the big thing to consider, right? you put a J-pipe on, you can make really good power. The other thing is, that people really don't talk about, is the idea that the power plateaus. There aren't rational steps to making more and more and more and more power, right? Those steps increase in cost every step you take, complexity, and significantly change reliability and drivability. Two different things. Reliability, if it's going to be break, if something might go out or break or something like that, and your car might not be working. Drivability, in that it's not a convenient car to drive on a regular basis. I kid you not, if you look through most of the Subaru community forums and all that stuff, people are gonna tell you you can make whatever power you want if you just spend a couple thousand dollars. You wanna make more power, a couple thousand dollars, and that's probably even high. Most people will say, use J-pipe, tune, intake, $2,000, tuned, pro tune, and everything, and you're good to go. I typically agree with that, but then anything more, you're talking thousands, and it's gonna significantly affect your ability to drive this car. It becomes impractical. My takeaway here is the number one thing that I wish I knew before buying this car is, and tuning it, and trying to build it, and before I made the decision with this was the car that I was going to build, modify, and drive, was I wish I knew that there is significantly more money in play to do that. And when you want to make real power, you really have to start giving things up, like the gas stations you go to. The list goes on, really. It changes the ability to drive this car comfortably over a long term, and the daily driving is just like, woo. So the second thing I wish that I knew before driving and modifying this car is that these cars become so alike, and there seems to be one natural path to modifying them, and then it's a tricky situation to be unique, which isn't a bad thing, and not everyone wants to be unique, but as a car person, I want my car to be unique, and it's hard to break away from the norm here. So that's just a short one, not too much more to mention about it. And then the third one, and this is a big one. I wish I had known the real numbers and proportions of issues people face when they modify these cars. What do you mean? These cars have, you know, whether you're driving an EJ motor in an STI or an FA20 in a WRX, both have different issues, but problems with transmissions, problems with engines are a lot more common than people lead you to believe. And I'm not saying everyone's gonna have a problem and every car is gonna break, but I am saying you're not immune. And it, you know, most communities and most people will tell you that WRX is a fail-safe way to tune, modify, and get going. Especially the newer models, you know, a lot of people, like, everybody says head gaskets, everybody says rod knock, everybody says all those good things, but they all say it around the older EJs and the older cars, but these cars have their problems and they have issues. So that's another thing that I really wish I knew about. There are two more, essentially. I think, you know, the fourth one, I think we're on number four, I can't really remember at this point, was I wish I knew more about the community itself. And I've got to say, for the most part, the Subaru community is an amazing place to be around. Most people are absolutely amazing. No, you interact with these awesome people on a regular basis. But you also have some pretty horrible people, especially online, especially in the Facebook groups. You know, let's say you're unlucky enough to buy a WRX with a CVT transmission. RIP. I mean, there's like, you're going to get absolutely roasted on a regular basis on the Facebook groups, which are, you know, basically the source of the biggest communities around these cars. And you've got people that are fragile and they're very direct, they're very aggressive, and I've got no words essentially to describe how hurtful a lot of these people are. Now, I've got a very thick skin myself because I'm posting content on YouTube and I get, you know, hate on a very regular basis, but a lot of people don't, and it actually turns a lot of people away from this car and owning these cars. So it's something to think about. And it's something to pretty much heavily consider. Just pulled into the house here, so we're gonna bring the video to a close right now. Something to pretty heavily consider, and it's a huge negative, and I know that we're not driving anymore. I've gotta get home to do some work on the car and get some parts installed before it gets too dark here, so that's why we're home already. So this isn't meant to be a super long video, but there's a lot of hate, and it's something that I wish I had known before. It's not gonna really affect me, but I think that I'm making this video to tell you guys about exactly what's going on. And, you know, it's something to think about. You know, if you, not every community is perfect, but this one's definitely, it's kind of like, I think, although people are going to hate me for saying this, the WRX and STI community is a lot, it's more similar to the Mustang communities than people really want to admit. and you get the same kind of bashing, you get all this hate, and you just, I don't really understand why. So again, it's not going to keep me from owning the car because I've got thick skin and I don't really, other than on YouTube, I don't really see it. Definitely saw it when I was in a CVT, but I joined the CVT side. But I see it too often, and I get people way too often messaging me being, pretty down about having a WRX and the reaction of other people to the WRX. So the final thing that I wish I knew, and this is the most important. So if you stuck this far through the video, I appreciate it, and you're going to reap the most rewards. The final thing I wish I knew is how much these cars are beat on, and the amount of lack of knowledge about the cars and what's safe and how you should tune them and prep the cars for good driving and all those things. It's remarkable what people do to these cars and then how much time they spend putting it back to stock and selling it to you as if none of that was done to the car. So if I was in this process again, I think that I've gotten pretty lucky. I've vetted both owners pretty well, and at this point I've had this car for a long time. Be very careful when you buy these things used especially. The car has likely been beat on by a young individual who's just getting into sports cars, doesn't understand it, doesn't understand what needs to be done. The amount of times I hear of intakes being run without tunes, people putting J-pipes on, running it for a couple months before they go get a pro tune, things that are just horrible. And other things, it would blow your mind what people do with these cars. That said, I wish I had known that. Well, I hope you guys know that and get into that and put that frame of mind on before you buy one of these cars. I think it's a very important aspect of owning and buying a WRX or an STI is just understanding what you're getting into, what, you know, the history of the car is. Make sure you buy a car that hasn't been abused, that's been cared for right, and that you can, that the owner can prove the maintenance and prove the care to you. One of the beautiful things about owning a YouTube channel is I document pretty much everything with this car, so I can be pretty transparent when I sell it and when I move on to the next Subaru for the garage. But I'm gonna let you guys go. Thank you for being here. I hope you enjoyed the video. Stay safe, guys. Thank you for being here.